All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming today. We're just a minute or two away, so I'm going to start getting started. Just to get a sense of the audience, how many people here have seen me speak before? A couple of people? Okay, good.
How many people have seen what?
Have seen me speak before. Oh. I've heard the jokes I'm about to tell. Yeah. No, I don't really reuse jokes, but, and that was one of them, I kind of want to get a sense of how many people here are working with AI today, already have an AI project in place. Just a couple people. How many people are using decision trees to choose algorithms and machine learning? Just a few people. Okay. It's ranked as an intermediate course. They asked me to make this sort of a non-introductory, so to jump straight into some stuff. So I'll try to do a little bit more background, but generally I'm going to rush through what it is we're talking about in terms of like what is an algorithm and why is it biased. But I think the point of the presentation should be self-evident, is to think at a higher level anyway. So hopefully that comes through. As much as I'd like to give you a detailed explanation of how it works. It reminds me when I used to speak about Hadoop security in the early days of big data security, I would explain how Hadoop worked. And it's totally irrelevant now in big data. Nobody wants to know how Hadoop works. They just turn it on and they use it. But I think this is going to be more important because you're not going to be able to avoid this the way you can avoid a Hadoop risk. Does anybody use Hadoop? Ah, see. 5 years ago, it was all the rage. All right. A couple more people. Ready? All right. We're right at 3:40, so let's get started. Today's topic is Breaking Bad AI, and I make a play on the television show, which you might have seen, called Breaking Bad. It's an interesting show because it does relate very clearly to the topic today of artificial intelligence, because it's about a guy who essentially is a teacher, a trusted person that you would want to have teaching your kids, who goes very bad and does basically drug dealing, gets very embroiled in a criminal lifestyle. So the abstract is really about how in the past we dealt with a lot of infrastructure risk, cloud security. I wrote a book about it in 2012. And on top of that, we run a lot of data analysis, which turns out to be a completely different discipline. The more I dive into it, I've been writing a book for almost 8 years about it, the more I realize the sands are shifting. Hadoop, for example, isn't relevant because a lot of it isn't about the infrastructure. A lot of it's a much higher level. In other words, there are two classes of breaking, which is why Breaking Bad is so important as a concept. Breaking a nail, bending a nail, for example, is kind of like you replace that nail. But if you have a fundamentally flawed nail because of reasons that it was manufactured wrong, you throw away the whole bag. So when do you know to not trust the entire system of engineering as opposed to just replace the thing with a patch or a fix? And this is kind of a fundamental problem in philosophy, and famously, a lot of the surrealists asked, is this really a pipe? It's a drawing of a pipe. So what is real? What's surreal? So there's a lot of human history to this, but I found Breaking Bad as a term goes back to the 1880s, and I'm pretty sure no one else has done this, so welcome to a disclosure. Basically, I found in the Supreme Court of the United States in New York that they talked a lot about Breaking Bad as things like Jersey Lightning, which if you're not familiar is a type of moonshine that basically would wreck you as a person, couldn't make good judgments. But they were talking specifically about if I would make a steal and I gave it to you and you relied on it, it could break in a bad way that would blow up or destroy everything around you. Like a screw would fail, the heads would fall off. And that is exactly what happened. So if you look at the 1770s very quickly, the piston engine was designed to save lives in mines. It was pumping water out so people would live. And then very quickly they found out, although you'd say in hundreds of years, but they did find out that these piston engines could go very bad. So by 1905, has anyone heard of the Grover Shoe Factory disaster? There's a turning point in engineering in the world, let alone America. 50 people died and 2 city blocks were burned to the ground from one simple crack in a boiler engine, in a steam engine. And so 2 years later, laws were written, everybody changed how they did engineering. From that point on, operational safety laws were essential to engineering. And when I mean operational safety laws, I'm saying it's not just that there's a crack and you have to fix or patch the system. You have to think about the ecosystem you're operating in to make sure you don't kill everybody in a factory and the city blocks around you. So this is a different way of looking at things that break. And another way of looking at it maybe is in the 1950s, facial recognition started. Everybody know this? 1960s, we had basically the beginnings of, this is from the 1960s, this file, but in the 1950s, they were thinking about World War II and obviously how quickly you can recognize things that you would need to shoot down, the enemy. So they were using that to hopefully save lives by the 1960s, building these technologies. So 60 years later, have we had any instances of Breaking Bad? Have we had like the Grover Shoe Factory disaster? Has anyone thought of any like massively bad? And you, there's tons of data, and I'll show you some of that today. But what I noticed was in my own career path, I started off on the right side there, working on presentation results. My background's in social science and a lot of like the results of what's a trusted report. Why would you trust analysis? I come from history background. So I'm gonna give you some history today, and you may ask, why should I trust this guy? Well, that's what I started in. And then second is infrastructure. I spent 25 years building trusted infrastructure to the point where I wrote a book about how to make cloud safe. But then I realized people were putting all this data on top of the cloud, and you're putting all of your personal body of data into the cloud, trusting it, but should you? So as my career moved up the stack, if you will, or from right to left, I also noticed that people have no consent or control over the use of their data when someone else is profiting. This is a very weird position to be in as a historian, because it reminds me of things. So I'll give you an example first of what Breaking Bad might look like if you say, has anyone had a Breaking Bad incident? How many people know in 2007 there was an automated anti-aircraft gun? The beginning of cyber, the beginning of recognition was anti-aircraft guns, predicting where a plane would go, recognizing it as an enemy plane, and shooting it basically in the future. So in 2007, they had exactly that. They had this beautiful computer system that would shoot the bad guys. And what happened? It killed everybody who ran the gun. Have you heard of this? It amazes me that we talk about this topic and no one talks about this incident, because the people who were running it tried to stop it. And if you can see here in the small text, it ran 360 degrees like a high pressure hose, emptying its entire, shells at a rate of 550 a minute, emptying its entire, the canister. And basically they chalked it up as a computer gremlin had taken over the gun, killed everybody. It was all women, incidentally. So what happened after that? In 2020, the South African government basically came out and said, you can't trust an algorithm, how smart, no matter how smart, to kill the correct target. This is not an adequate answer. Now, I understand what they're saying. After 2007 to 2020, they still believe that you can't trust any guns that are automated, you can't trust AI. But the alternative is that we have specialized warriors like the Green Berets, which isn't a terrible concept. Kennedy here is talking to the first Green Beret, basically in history, officially calling them Green Berets and saying, what your job is to use guns to prevent violence. It's counterintuitive. So can you get a gun to prevent violence? Could you use that gun that killed everybody who was operating it to actually stop violence? It can't even identify the right people to shoot. So my argument here is gonna be that you can't scale Green Berets the way that we'd like to. Specialized warriors are not the answer. So we need a better answer. And the unfortunate thing is we're running out of time, because AI already has become a weapon of choice. It isn't just that gun that's supposed to shoot things. It's actually invasive into our entire lives. And that's because it slashes the transaction costs of the information that we're seeing. And that is the definition of warfare. So if you study war like I have, and if you study combat and conflict, you realize power shifts are based on information deception. And so here on the right, I give an example where if you took some machine gunners, which were a revolution for World War I, it was a huge power shift to have automation, and you looked at them and you saw somebody going fishing, would you be prepared to defend yourself? Well, guess what happens if you put that image into Google image results? If you can see in the small print, it comes up as fishing. Not a joke. It recognizes those guys with a machine gun at the beginning of World War I as going fishing. So the point here today, if there's nothing else you take away, I hope, is that the direct impact on human liberties is unavoidable at this point. AI is interfering with democracy. It is really at the core of the problems ahead. Security professionals have to think completely differently. You have to think about the boiler in the Grover Shoe Factory burning down everything and everyone around, not just having a crack that you fix with a patch. It's more systematic than that. And so I say for here, as an example, Facebook can no more claim that its products protect our privacy than Coke could start saying that their sugary drinks are going to make us healthier. And if you've read the book Pure, White, and Deadly, an actual book by John Yudkin, he predicted a lot of the problems we have today, and they're related to sugar. And so there's a lot of predictions I'm going to try to give you today, probably not as excellent as Yudkin, but I would like to aspire to that kind of warning about the future. And what I'm seeing already, and this is no joke, is the far-right white supremacist groups are using AI to wage global asymmetric battles against liberty and freedom. So not only are we primed for this problem, and not only is AI being used as a weapon, but we might not be prepared to stop these people from using it. And another way of looking at this is AI adoption is way up because people are in a race to get to this thing they perceive as a beautiful future. It's the sort of supersize me, if you will, of the technology space. And so we're seeing a 1,200% growth in the next 6 years prediction. We're seeing $52 billion in the next 3 years. And that's because there's an existential threat perceived by people who are operating in business environments saying, we may go out of business if we don't get AI in here quickly. Which to me sometimes sounds like people saying, as a restaurant owner, if we don't start serving Coke and fries, we're going to go out of business. We need a mechanized way, a more efficient way of having machines presenting food to people. But how many people today go into a restaurant and say, how many vending machines do you have back there? I really need to be served by a vending machine or a robot. It's counterintuitive when you think about what actually is the experience of eating and food today, but that is essentially what I hear when I hear people saying we need AI quickly in our environments to give us a better chance of survival in this world of business. So 84% of people think they must leverage AI to actually get profit. This is a questionable situation we're in because, and this is where it starts to get scary, so a bit of a trigger warning, I'm going to talk about some really bad problems that have been happening because of this. So for example, we may think we want scientifically healthy human life, but that seems fairly unlikely given our history with the health industry and the way that we adopted sugar when it was actually bad and we had predictions about how bad it would be. But even worse is weaponized tech seems very, very likely to cause a lot of deaths. Anyone who tells you that they're going to reduce pedestrian deaths with automated cars, for example, is not to be believed. I can show you right here that the head of Mercedes-Benz Active Safety said, we're going to be sacrificing lives of pedestrians. That is the most honest answer I've seen of any car company describing the future of automated cars. Because we're seeing an increase of pedestrians being killed, and despite all the technology, we're seeing a monthly death toll of the equivalent of a jumbo jet, and nobody's working on pedestrian deaths. Don't believe me? March 2018, Uber killed a woman who was a pedestrian. Why? Easily predictable. They ignored cars running on sidewalks. They ignored 15,000 miles having an accident, a vehicle being damaged nearly every other day. They measured only the metric of miles driven, which, a little spoiler alert, philosophers would tell you, if you measure how often you do 2 + 2 correctly, it doesn't make you an advanced mathematician. So the amount of miles you drive does not mean you've done anything interesting or significant or desirable. It means you've made it a mile. Has that mile had any significance to the desire to save a pedestrian's life? It's not in the text. So what you see here is pedestrians are already disadvantaged, and then we killed a pedestrian because of course we are. They're going to be sacrificed for the greater good of cars being automated. See what I'm saying? All right. So an alternate title, a joke if you will, is The Truth is History, a bit of a pun, and I find real ignorance in artificial intelligence products. So another way of looking at that is I could have replaced myself with a bot today. Why am I up here speaking when I can have a chat bot? I could have programmed the Sun Tzu bot, for example, to just tell you these simple things. The art of war is vital, of importance. All warfare is deception. And if there's a protracted campaign, then the state will be overstrained. And then ultimately, there's no country that has benefited from prolonged warfare. So if you can use deception long enough, the state fails. That's a Sun Tzu bot. Perhaps you would have confused it with me. I could have disguised it. But they didn't like that. RSA said no bots allowed to represent you in the speaking. You have to be authentic. So what I'm going to talk to you about next is a very important history lesson. And I don't know many people that tell this very well. I think history is often mistaught. There's a lot of deception in our history books, especially in America. So let me just give you a quick quiz. Who was Katie Green Miller, or Katie Green? Any ideas? Any answers? What did she invent? Why did she invent it? 1793, critical year in American history. She invented the cotton gin. Did you know? There's a woman who invented the cotton gin. Why did she invent it? Well, there was this guy, Nathaniel Green, her husband, who was a revolutionary hero. He became a general who saved the South. He was actually called Savior of the South, or Commander-in-Chief of the Southern Army. And he had an agile mindset, which destroyed the British. He was able to be agile in failing and repeating and failing and repeating. Sound familiar to today's models of business? And so he was driven to revolutionize America, no pun intended. And so he dedicated his life. And after the war, he was driven to poverty by the Southerners. But they said, we'll make you a deal. Even though we've defrauded you and taken all of your money, we'll give you a farm with a plantation, a large plantation with slaves on it. So you just have to work the slaves and you'll get all of the money that you deserve. But he was an abolitionist and he said no. So instead he tried to work the land himself and he died. So Katie said, this is ridiculous. I'm gonna build a machine, an engine to do the work of humans. I'm not gonna get into the slavery thing. And so she gets a guy off the boat, literally a student who had just arrived, had no background in any of this, and said, can you design me a cotton gin? And he says, yes. He builds the cotton gin. She marries the man on her farm who's running it at that point, the plantation runner, because women don't exist in America at this point. She can't have a patent. So the patent goes to Miller and Whitney, and then they get no money because they try to set up a cloud service. I'm not joking. They actually tried to set up a service where everybody who processed cotton would actually pay them a small fee, and nobody paid. Not only did they not pay, they broke into their plans, and they stole the IP, and everybody made cotton gins from that point forward. So, who was she? Well, she was somebody who really wanted to end slavery and emancipate women. And instead, very quickly, what we saw was the opposite, the huge boom in slavery. In fact, because they had banned the importation of slaves, it became state-sanctioned rape of women. So in a very short time, every black woman was basically targeted to produce women every child every 18 months, and they had to produce like 8 to 10 children. And so you see a rampant increase from a ban on slavery to a period where, with no ban on slavery, it went from less than 1 million to over 4 million slaves. And so Lincoln describes this in 1838, this process as, if you object to the use of the cotton gin with slaves, you get killed. You can't object to that use of it. And so you get to a point where in 1859, they hang the person who objects most vociferously, John Brown. He said, you can no longer use slaves. Slaves should not be allowed. And they hang him, and the South says, ha, we've proven our point. Nobody will challenge us at this point because we've hung at a federal level a person who objects to us. Well, the opposite was true. What you actually found was then the entire Civil War erupts. And the war was about the transfer of power. So if you look at the Breaking Bad definition, which is there's a lot of cheating, there's a lot of greed, and then eventually you slide into war because people are using machines for unjust power, that slide is exactly what we're going to see today. So, who was she? She wanted to have freedom and equality, and instead she ended up with this enslavement, exploitation, and erasure of women. And that is why when people say driverless cars will stop killing pedestrians, I say, or the opposite. In fact, if you look at a lot of historic lessons, what you find is a lot of technology is used to transfer power to people who use it unjustly, and then you get a ton of problems. You get Amazon trucks driving around the city killing cyclists. Perhaps you didn't hear, but Amazon killed one of its own executives with one of its delivery vehicles who was cycling in the bike lane. But that didn't stop Amazon. They didn't make any changes after that. So, fast forward to today, and the need to emancipate our data bodies, because our bodies now are represented in data inside platforms, becomes a totally different discussion. This is not my idea. A lot of people talk about data bodies, but you have to ask if Facebook could be seen as a modern slavery engine. And I actually hear people at Facebook say things like, you poor users, you can't take care of yourselves. Why don't you give all of your data to us and we'll take care of you for you? So it's sort of a question of, would you actually be able to stop the engine expansion into new unregulated markets? And this is no joke. What's happening is Facebook is not growing at all in the United States or places where people start to say, I want my privacy, I want my rights, I want my liberty, and I feel like I'm being unjustly treated. My body of data isn't being represented. So what happens is they go to countries like Cambodia and they expand massively and very quickly, which is like in the United States when we said no more slavery and they expanded into the Western territories. The whole war was about stopping the expansion of slavery. And so that's where it becomes really interesting because I don't know if you've seen this, but Google literally went out, literally took phones and put it in front of people and lied to them and said, we want your data and you really want to do this. And they targeted homeless black people in order to get their data into the system so that they could improve their algorithms, literally using bodies of data. Which is very similar to my mind when I read about 1854 kidnappers and slave catchers going around and trying to find vulnerable people that they can sell. All right, so let's tie it all back together. What you see essentially is, if you know the saying, de oppresso liber, is you send in some special forces people and you say, that looks like someone is being oppressed, so maybe I can convince you to stop oppressing. Maybe I can get rid of these data bodies that are being held against their will and liberate them. The problem is, in order to do what the special forces were really designed to do, you have to be able to identify what you're really trying to, what type of technology you're trying to solve. Like, if it's a cog in a system, a nail that's bending, then of course you replace the cog, or you break break the cog. I mean, it's a very simple exchange and inexpensive replacement proposition. But if you're talking about meat space and cognition, it's very expensive to change people's mind about things. And perhaps all of you are sitting there thinking, I've never heard any of this before. Why is this guy trying to convince me about, you know, Katie inventing the cotton gin? I've never heard that. But that's cognition, and that's what historians do, is we try to figure out what's right, what's wrong. In the modern context of technology, what we find is machine learning tends to be on the left. It's very simplistic, it tends to be statistical, but on the right, machine understanding, AI, is very complex. And in terms of what would fix it, the simple answer is a system of cognition that understands complex systems and relations will fix it. If you train systems, machines, the way we train humans, you'll see better results. Where does that happen? In Sweden. In socialist countries, you see people emphasize the connectivity of entire nations. But in America, you see specialized skill sets where people are treated as cogs. They're treated as labor. And they don't really understand how things fit together. Uber doesn't know that there are pedestrians on the street. Why would Uber think about that? Uber's trying to be Uber and drive miles. The more miles, the better the Uber. That's a very limited skill set. It's a very limited view of the entire world. All right. So if these machines are breaking bad, and science is the answer, socialism is a form of science, it's a manifestation of social science, where do you get trust in machines? How do you bridge the gap between the sciences? So I think this is difficult right now, because if you look around the world, there's at least 90 documents. This is already out of date. There are 84 documents at the time of writing on ethical AI. They had five principles, but trust me, I read about this stuff constantly. It's hard for me to keep up with all of the principles. If you look at a global map, this is a real map. You can actually slide on the right side up and down to see how fast these principles are growing. There's a lot of science. There's a lot of ethical principles. The DoD just announced their ethical principles this week, which is another five that you can read about. Harvard conveniently threw up on a page for us to show how many different principles there are and how they map to each other. Nobody wants to read through all this. It's crazy. But I can tell you, I mean, as a historian, when I walk into a library, I'm not going to read every book. I'm going to distill it down. I'm going to tell you like what actually happened, which is what I tried to do with Katie Green, for example. So same thing here. If you look at the EU Commission and ICO auditing principles that just came out, some of the most recent, most up-to-date principles, I can boil it down, distill it down into one thing, which is in 1792, a philosopher named Wollstonecraft, her daughter wrote Frankenstein, if that's a good reference for anyone. Anyway, so she comes up with this principle that the problem of bias is a lack of education. And she makes the very fine point that men tend to think of women as mistresses rather than affectionate wives and rational mothers. Why is this so essential? Because Hume in the 1740s had a treatise of human nature, which was the beginning of cognitive science. And he said basically that you have to have desire before you have reason. Now remember what I was saying about the Uber? You have to desire not to hit a pedestrian before you measure how you're doing in terms of driving on the road. And Wollstonecraft established this whole idea that there's equality. That's a desire that we should have. So don't enslave blacks. Don't treat women as unequal. And she actually literally wrote this in 1792 at the time that Katie was inventing the cotton gin. So that's not a coincidence. Global thinking at the time was that women would be emancipated and slavery would end. And so what she was saying is, if you're going to measure intelligence, if you're going to try to figure out how to make intelligence safe, or AI safe, or human intelligence safe, you're going to look for rational sympathy and benevolence. Now, this is just one angle on science. If you look at natural science, Einstein said, hey, there's imagination and there's knowledge. And I can tell you imagination is more important. Same thing. You got to have desire. You might not know how to get there, but you know you want to get there. And then the knowledge fills in behind it. You can learn the stuff behind it. Or if you look at life sciences, a lot of people don't realize, but the alphas and betas are often quoted backwards. The alpha is somebody who protects, who creates kindness, who creates generosity, who creates love, who basically is a parent who takes care of everyone else. Anytime somebody says, I'm an alpha personality, ask yourself, are they kind, generous, and loving? Do they create a calming effect around them? If not, they're a beta. A beta is a child. A beta demands to be fed. A beta demands to be clothed. A beta demands to be warm. People who demand things and say, I get what I want, those are children who are betas. But let's look at fictional science, because sometimes science fiction is working for people. If you look at Blade Runner, they basically say, you're in a desert, there's a turtle, you flip it over, you're not helping it. Why aren't you helping it? They're trying to make the point that if you're a robot, we can detect you because you're not desiring a beneficent world, right? So let's get back to engineering. In applied science, this is not made up. If you look at the desirability of cognizance, true engineers, chemical engineers, mechanical engineers, anybody who's aeronautical engineers, nautical engineers, they're supposed to be thinking about the economics of operation, the safety to life and property. We don't have that in software. I teach computer science every year for years, and I always have people asking me, like, do they need to be ethical in computer science? But you don't have that in other forms of engineering. It's a very strange situation we're in. So you should have full cognizance. Okay, so how are we gonna fix this? Real science. What's different about today is things move much faster. So while Katie Green probably had no chance to basically undo the effects of the cotton gin in her lifetime, Tim Berners-Lee has come forward and said, I don't like how people use the technology. I don't like that people are using the web to centralize it and enslave people. And he said, I'd like to fix that. So I'm going to fix it by reinventing it. And what he's saying is he's going to decentralize it. So actually you find that you can get to a safer state of AI if you use a scientific approach that says we should really rotate towards the centricity being around the user, and we should really balance knowledge with privacy. The opposite of privacy is knowledge. I think that's often misstated because people are like privacy, 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 but they don't realize they're losing knowledge. And when you say, would you give up the cure to cancer? They say, oh, actually, I probably would want to cure cancer. Okay, so you give up some privacy. So when you balance privacy and knowledge in that way, you start to ask, how do we get both? They're not a continuum that goes one way. They can actually be orthogonal. So you can say you get more privacy and more knowledge. Google's released a paper on this recently where they're starting to understand that the idea is safe knowledge. So we want things like confidentiality, integrity, resistance to threat. We want things that are beneficial. They have a moral foundation, safety in the design. Right? And morality in the design. Can they be reversible? So if you make a safety mistake, can you undo it? If it is immoral, can you stop it? And in more specific terms, can you have a power off button? Can you literally shut something down that you don't want to work anymore and terminate it? And in a sense, if you say, I'm afraid you no longer can have this space, it shouldn't object to you and say, I'm the determinant of whether I get this space or not, which is the subject of every science fiction movie that has robots. It's, you know, you can't stop the robot. And Blade Runner, for example, is killing the robot and all that stuff. So the power button is not a novel concept, but it is something that is new in our internet space when we have robots. I'm not kidding when I have large global companies asking me, can you find all of our robots that people created, figure out what they're doing, and get rid of them if they're doing bad things? People just don't know, with all the automation, what's going on inside their companies after they write these robots. That's the real world we're living in today. And so facial recognition is definitely one of these. So for example, just very quickly, I'll breeze through these now. You have reversible access. So user consent control means I can take back consent. I consent to give you access so you can have a cancer solution, but I don't like the way you're doing it. I reverse that consent. It's very difficult to do on platforms that own you. But if you own the platform and the data, you can obviously do that. You can power off using user centricity because you can say, I'm going to take back the control of the identity. I'm not going to give you access to my data, right? You no longer get access. A really good example of this is, you know, you get issued an identity, you travel around with it, but when the lodge wants you to have, when you want to verify your identity to the lodge or to the meal or to the transit, whenever you go into a different situation, you can actually present a form of identity that they only need for that particular transaction. So software can give you better identity control over the data that people can access. And this basically gets rid of the old Lockean philosophy of just more and more data gets us to a better place. If we just reason enough, we'll get to a safer world. Locke is wrong, and Hume, who came 50 years later, said it's wrong because it doesn't establish the desire to see better. I mean, it's great that you can look at pixels and end up with what looks like light and dark faces, but it doesn't tell you if you're actually seeing something good or bad, or you should be doing that in the first place. So why aren't we focusing on this desirable benevolence? Why aren't we seeing the relations? Another way of asking it is, for fraud, maybe it's okay to be 90% accurate. But if I'm doing facial recognition, why shouldn't I set the bar at 99% accurate? Why should I allow anything lower than 99% accuracy? Wouldn't that be harmful? So that's a real philosophical question. But let's look again at driverless cars as an example of AI. 1 in 4 adults in the United States, I don't know if you know this or not, have a major disability. But driverless cars can't see people with disabilities. They run over people in wheelchairs. Why is that? Because they didn't think about it in terms of, would it be bad if I ran over somebody in a wheelchair? They just said, if I study enough data, I'm sure I won't do bad things. This is the do no evil concept as opposed to, I should do good things. Another example of this is when you look at all of the AI engines that are doing bad things and they're breaking badly, you have to ask what were their desires. So I can give you lots of examples. There are literally dozens and dozens of these. But for example, you want to feed people pancakes, so you tell the robot to do a flourish by throwing the pancake high, and you get points for throwing it particularly high. It decides to throw them so high nobody eats. You say, I want to measure your speed. What's the evolutionary principle that makes the fastest robot possible? The robot decides to stand in one place and fall over because the rate of falling is faster than actually taking a step forward. So it just gets infinitely tall and falls over and over again. So nobody moves, nobody eats. A driving robot is told not to run into the bumpers, so it just drives around running into everybody sideways. So everybody's crashing all the time. And everyone loses in a tic-tac-toe game because you say, okay, you should play and let's see who wins based on algorithms. And one of the bots decides, well, I'm just going to move a piece so far out, it's outside the memory space of the other bots. So anything that tries to map the space that I just gave them, the coordinates, crashes because it runs out of memory. So everybody loses the game except for me because nobody can move. Paralysis. So what is it doing? It's desiring to do things that are essentially flawed. It's like cheating. And so when you look at the sympathy or benevolence in machine learning algorithm trees, you don't find it anywhere. You find some form of accuracy, but accurate to what? That's, again, empirical evidence, Lockean. You find speed, but faster isn't necessarily better. So rarely do I see people saying, what is the benevolence of the systems we're building? In fact, in 2020, a report on the data used to recognize things in the street had a 33% failure rate. It couldn't see pedestrians. It couldn't see cyclists. This is the de facto data set that is being used to train algorithms. It can't see things. They weren't labeled. Another way of looking at it is, in 2020, the report came out that the Tesla crashed into the crash attenuator, killing the driver. What is a crash attenuator? It's supposed to prevent crashes. What did the Tesla not see? The thing that's supposed to prevent the crashes. It ran directly into it. And the latest news that just came out today is that the Tesla is the only car company that did not get back to the regulators about what they're doing about this problem. All the other car regulators are saying that all the other car manufacturers are making changes to make the cars safer. Tesla refuses to reply. So let me give you some more examples of that in terms of Tesla. So it decided to decapitate an owner in 2016. I've given several talks about this. It intentionally chose the most dangerous route and the most likely to kill the driver. Okay, let's fast forward to 2019. What's happening? The exact same thing. Tests prove that it's still driving under that tractor trailer, treating it as a decapitation event. Different software, different hardware, same outcome. So you can't even blame the OEM that they're choosing. They replaced all of the guts of the AI engine, and they're still decapitating the owners of the cars. 2016, Teslas were easily run off the road. They couldn't see a stop sign. They couldn't see the difference between the word stop and the word no parking or speed limit. These are all tests that I've done personally. And I can tell you in 2017, we saw that it couldn't read a sign on the highway. It thought California 101 was actually a 105 mile an hour speed limit. In 2020, fast forward to today, a new report just came out and said if we extend the three a little bit, it thinks it's 85 miles an hour. 2016, it couldn't see humans, pointed this out. These are tests that I did. It couldn't see humans on the right. That's actually Tesla's campus. It drove around its own campus and couldn't see its own employees. 2016, Uber had the same problem. It didn't see the pedestrians in the crosswalk. It didn't see red lights. It literally was running red lights. So San Francisco said, get out. And they said, gladly, we're going to go to Arizona. Arizona is very pro-tech. So Uber literally rolled into Arizona, crashed. And then, tragically predictable, in 2018, what you saw was Uber killing a woman. Why was it so predictable? Well, let's look at Arizona. It has the highest rate of pedestrian deaths in the United States. It has 70% of pedestrian deaths at night. And jaywalking is a fantasy crime. You should treat people in the street as humans. They don't lose rights. That's a fantasy crime. It's a racist law. So given those three things, you put Uber in Arizona, you should, in terms of science, if you're using science and you're engineering, you put a car at night in Arizona, pedestrians in the middle of the road should be your number one concern. And what did they do? They removed the sensors, they ignored all the reports, and they ran over exactly the thing that they probably would run over. So, why? So, let me give you a quick approach to how we're going to fix this, I believe. Testing is easy. I test all these systems, they fail very simply. If I pop up a balloon in the middle of a crosswalk before a car gets there, does it see the balloon? Uber could have done this. They could have tested automated blow-up doll over and over and over again until they saw it. I tested an algorithm that was supposed to see buildings and grass and streets, and it confused grass with a building because I moved the image to Africa instead of to Europe, and it was color coding. It was basically cheating by doing it's a color by number. So grass was the same color as a building. It's totally confused. These tests are so easy. Why? Why are you failing? So let me give you three examples. One, are you over-centralizing your data? So are you looking at small data sets? Because those are more relevant to the human condition. Are you going in and saying, what are you doing? What's your business logic? Can I look at that and help you with it? That would be augmentation of the human condition. Or are you just gathering huge amounts of data and saying, I found something. I have huge amounts of data and I discovered that this tan is a building. That's a terrible approach. That's very brittle. Are you looking for winning combinations? In a small data set, you need one lottery ticket to win the lottery. You don't need to get every lottery ticket. They all win the lottery. You just need the one that wins. You only win once, in other words. Even if you get five winning tickets, you win the lottery once. And a lot of AI is basically trying to, these are real studies, by the way, that they were over gathering data to win the lottery when they only needed one winning ticket. One of the more interesting ones recently is that you can actually segment the data to safeguard and make learning systems more robust. So in other words, in the battle space for the US Army, they say, well, what if we don't have access to all the data because it's being destroyed? Can we still make rational decisions? And the answer is yes. So not only is that better because it's more safe, but you actually get to the same answers more quickly. So are you over collecting data? You probably are. How small of data sets can you get away with to be accurate? And especially when you raise the bar to 99%, you can get pretty small data sets. That's the new truth. Two, are you over authorizing? So, is there a false neutrality in binary thinking to your systems? A way of expressing this might be labeling. It turns out if people have preconceived labels, when they look at a face like this and you say draw black or draw white, they draw them with racist tones because they've been learning the way Wollstonecraft warned us in a biased system. Now the answer here is not to get rid of labels, I'm sad to say. Labels are an efficiency. Remember when I talked about ERM and ICEA or gears and cognitive science? We use gears for efficiencies. We're always going to have labels. We can't function without labels. That's part of Hume's rational thinking as well. But the answer is to make the labels more accurate. So how do you get people to do things? Because it'll never be independent of labels. Well, one of the things to do is to say, how do I interact with society? If the labels are wrong, where does that come from? Was I told by an authority this label was right? Because that authority is wrong. And the ability to say to an authority that's telling you that something is right or wrong is very powerful. Because if they're always right no matter what, then you're in a bad state. And this is actually philosophical theory again that goes back to the 1700s. But the ability of humans to say, we can create a government that we can decide is wrong and change the government is what basically is happening here. Governance on the internet has to get to a state where we can actually interact with it in a way that we can say, I have a better idea. So an example of that would be, you can say, how much effort do I need to do to get rid of bad effects? There's lots of examples in safety engineering here, but like minimum endogenous mortality, ALARA, ALARP, all these things are basically saying, what is the natural rate of death and am I making it worse? So if Arizona already has a high level of mortality and you introduce driverless cars, does it go up? The answer is obviously yes, because Uber didn't look for them. So it would get way worse much faster, right? And so another way of looking at this is, are we looking at things in a very binary sense? Because if you make it a much more granular sense, if you look at things in a much more granular way, labels in particular, you don't want to look at everybody as either one or the good or bad. You might want to look at them on a power spectrum of, are they doing better or are they doing worse? And so this actually allows, in a more conservative AI model, to generate better probabilities that give you better results. All right, so the final one is, why over-authenticate? So basically, this is where I'm going to do some real tests. You have the erosion of liberty through tests of authenticity. The harm principle in ethics is, are you doing something which is causing people harm? It's very simple. And a lot of people you read on the internet today will say, what we really need to do is figure out who's authentic. This is harmful. Why? Because inauthenticity has a place. Have you ever watched a comedian who represents someone else? Have you ever seen a ventriloquist? Have you ever seen somebody impersonate another person with a voice as a joke? Have you heard of jokers? Have you heard of court jesters? Have you seen pen names? Have you seen people who use stage names? Have you seen actors who are pretending to be someone else? This is all inauthenticity. It is an essential part of our life to have inauthenticity. So companies that are saying, as a centralized data repository, we have to have absolute authenticity, may be taking you down the wrong path. What you really should be looking at is that comedian causing harm? Which is a very different question. That's basically a judgment, but it has to be decided by people. But that's really what you should be getting at. So why are you trying to authenticate so precisely that you get to exactly what that thing is as opposed to looking at what it's really doing? So for example, Gartner tells us that speech recognition is in the clear. It's in the plateau of productivity. We should all trust the speech recognition systems, which are really chatbots, but I'll give them the benefit of the doubt that they have chatbots in inflated expectations and speech recognition all the way to the right. Speech recognition itself has a lot of flaws, and I could go through them. It could be a presentation itself, how easy it's to break all of the speech recognition systems. And I've been working with it since 1996, 1997, I was working with speech recognition systems that IBM was developing in hospitals. So for a long time, we've known about a lot of these problems, like no privacy, no ability to understand flaws that you inject into it, allowing inputs that shouldn't be. But the latest flaws, though, are a very different spectrum. It's not just that I can break the gears again, it's that they're actually listening to everything you're doing without informing you. That's a very different break. That's a Breaking Bad. That's not a break. They're actually spying on you without you being informed. In fact, up to 19 times a day, the latest research shows, they're recording up to 43 seconds. In other words, every time you say, I can work, OK Google turns on. Every time you say Colorado, Cortana turns on. Every time you say heat clearly, Siri. And so this is like the version of Tesla where it can't see stop signs. It can't tell the difference between a red octagon and a white rectangle, just the way the voice can't tell the difference between don't stop and don't stop. See what I did there? Don't stop, don't stop. Don't stop. Don't stop. Don't stop. See? Which is it? How much productivity can you get from a system that can't tell the difference between don't stop and don't stop? All right. Now, again, we can break lots of these bots and a lot of these speech recognition systems. I want to point out that the chat bot that Microsoft launched was basically backdoored. It really wasn't an intelligence game, so I want to throw that aside just as a caveat. It's basically a dictation system that was very primitive. So Siri was a more troubling concern because you could just throw stuff into Wikipedia and it would immediately believe it was true. And so when people said, you know, tell me about Donald Trump, it would throw offensive pictures up. And their advertising was, whatever you want, we do. So maybe that's what people wanted. I don't know. Maybe it was a reflection of society. But also we see in 2020, the sands have shifted to the point where people are saying, we're not going to release MENA to the public because there are safety concerns. And I can tell you already, just by looking at their examples, I could break this because I see shortcuts being taken. So in 2020, the result, like I started with in the presentation, is to ban people from using these. It's like the automated guns. People are saying, don't use them. Let's just figure out a better way to do that. But I don't think that's really the answer. I think the answer is to fix the system, fix the labeling. And that is looking at the problem more closely to figure out why it's broken. For example, if you type in she is an engineer and you upload that, you say it, you upload it, whatever you want to do in Google, it'll translate it as a neutral, O beer muhendis. All right, so take O beer muhendis, translate it back to English, it says she, he. I started with she, but now it's back to she, he. Okay, gender neutral, fine, Turkish is gender neutral. What if I take the she is an engineer, put it into Turkish, take Turkish, flip it back to a different language, I'll say Yiddish here, for example. Well, now suddenly it's he is an engineer. How did I go through a process of filtering that ends up with he when I started with she? That seems wrong. Here's a better example. Urdu, basically she becomes he. Armenian, she becomes he. Now I become suspicious. Why is Turkish giving me a different result than all these other languages? So I put Turkish to the test. Every language except English, it converts to he. That's a cheat. That's a shortcut. That's like color by number. You're not seeing buildings, you're seeing tan. This is the sort of stuff that I hate. So what does that mean in real terms? The use of he in gender-neutral conversations denies women recognition. This is an actual quote from a woman. And so it erases people. And so what you actually see in Swahili, just as an example, if you take she is an engineer and you translate it, it comes out as he is an engineer. But then if you erase is an engineer, it goes back to she. Why is that labeling broken? The answer is not to make it gender neutral. The answer is to fix the problem. What aspects of society are feeding into these language recognition systems that are causing this break? Very different than it's just breaking and we need to make sure everyone who speaks English sees gender neutral because they complain the most in the press. But every other language that's being violated doesn't have the same voices as people who speak English. That's a terrible answer. So I'm not the first to point this out. It's been pointed out a lot. I started pointing it out in 2014, I will say. But you know, Joy did some amazing work where she actually proved that this woman was seen as a man. Who is this woman? Sojourner Truth. Why is she so important? She wrote the most famous human rights speech in American history called Ain't I a Woman? And Google, IBM, Microsoft, Facebook all see her as a man. That's crazy history. That's really crazy. And she was one of the people that suffered under the cotton gin. She was forced to breed. She had 13 children. She tried to reclaim her own children as free. And that was one of the problems that she spoke about. So in conclusion, what I see most recently, which is also most troubling, is that Google has decided in its wisdom, I put big tech here, that they're not going to use labels anymore to pertain to gender because they can't deduce someone's gender by appearance alone. They're literally saying the AI cannot tell what gender you are, therefore we're going to put person in every time you say, here's an image, who is in it? They used to say he, she, but people were offended. Now, maybe for good reason. They were wrong. They made a mistake. But is that the answer? How many people would say that's the right answer? Anybody? Who wants to be called a person instead of a man or a woman? Let me make it even more important. There are about, I think, 6 or 7 states in the United States right now that will allow you an X. You can be a man, a woman, or an unspecified. These are identity systems, localized identity systems, that you would get a driver's license from, or a birth certificate, or whatever you want, where you can actually put an X in. Doesn't that sound like a reasonable solution? So Google walked away, stepped back, and said, hey, you're blaming us for making a mistake. So what we're going to do is just pretend like we see everyone as persons, and we have no visibility into their life condition. That is literally the opposite of what we should be doing. We should be stepping into the life conditions and saying, we understand what your conditions are, where you're coming from, and who you are as a person. And that is why decentralization is so powerful, because it gives people the ability to represent themselves accurately, as opposed to being put into a system that denies them an identity altogether. In fact, if you look at the 1960s, the famous philosopher Hannah Arendt said it was the triumph of the Nazi system that to take people who felt that they were being tortured or denied rights, who were enslaved, and to get them to a point where they abandoned their own identity, where they began to see themselves not as humans, and gave up. And Google, in a sense, is giving up. And so the point today is, when you look at fixing systems, we went very quickly from a world where we were trying to fix the infrastructure. We were actually trying to go into the systems, the big data systems, if you will, that we were running on top of, and we were trying to put encryption in. Done that. We're trying to put in so privacy, confidentiality. We're trying to go in and make sure that we had strong identity controls. So second factor authentication, done that. But all these things don't fix the problem of somebody making a decision that when you ask it, am I a man or a woman, it says, I can't tell you, you're a person. Because you're only one step away from not being a person at that point. Does that make sense? So that essentially is the presentation. I thank you very much for sticking through it all. And take any questions now. Ask anything.
I'm just going to ask your thoughts on maybe the ethical use of AI in things like Facebook and things like that to try to discern true stories or, you know, legitimate news from inaccurate and, you know, kind of fake news, propaganda, whatever you want to call it, and what's the ethical implications of making an algorithm that kind of suppresses certain things that it determines, you know, not to be true and things like that.
Yeah, very good question. So the question is, you know, how do I see Facebook in particular around their efforts to get rid of inauthentic text or inauthentic conversation? So there's two parts to this question. One is, we saw in 2017 a rise of inauthentic speech, basically conspiracy theories that were used in genocide. So what responsibility does the platform have to look at the inauthentic speech and try to get rid of that in a way that would prevent the loss of life? Genocide, obviously, terrible outcome. So I would always say that is a, like integrity in security historically, is a problem of harm, right? Harm principle coming through your system that you should stop. It would be no different for me than if chemical engineers said that there's a poison in the plumbing and they should try to filter that out. Or if, in terms of computers, we had malware on our systems. By definition, it's malware. It's malicious software. We should prevent the malicious software from coming into the system. Do we have firewalls? We're preventing malicious packets from coming into our networks. So on the same principle, there should be filtering using an integrity mindset on that. The second part of that, though, is from where does authority flow? And this is where they pushed back. Facebook actually said, you don't want us being an Orwellian state. And I think this is where they're wrong. Because you have no choice. You can't get off Facebook if you don't like how it's being run and go to some other Facebook. So in a sense, they've become the place that you rely on. This was brought up in the presentation, the keynotes, where they said Crypto AG was the big partner that you should trust because they'd do it right. Don't try to build your own crypto. Well, you go to that place to trust they would do the right thing, and they didn't do it. So the question becomes, do they have an authority to do it? And I would say absolutely in that case, but not all cases. So there are cases where authenticity should not be, and this is what their point was about Orwellian, but if you're not preventing people from having a voice, then you're not really doing harm, if that makes sense. The Onion, for example, very useful newspaper, completely fabricated news, says what people really think, but it's all made up. So it's completely inauthentic by people who don't exist. but it serves a very important purpose. But the question is there harm behind it? And that's where people get caught up, I think, is they don't know how to manage the harm principles because they haven't really studied what I would call the nadir of cognitive science around Hume, who's saying, like, look at, here's an effective way to behave in society. You get like a sort of percentage of effectiveness. You don't want to go too far because it's too expensive, but you want to go far enough that you're not causing harms. And how do you represent those harms? Well, look at the impact, the social impact. And this is why I say socialism is a form of this. You're looking at the social good and trying to figure out what would be the best course. And a lot of people walk away from that in America for the wrong reasons. So I think I have actually written blog posts around the liability of the CSO for atrocity crimes and whether he should go to jail. I think there's a legal case to be made for his negligence. And as much as people say, oh my God, don't hold security people negligible in these cases, I think this is a clear case where he not only was negligent, but he sat on top of, in 2017, 2018, clear harms, clear damages, and didn't do enough to stop that from flowing through his system.
Kind of to that point, what do you think where do you think regulation can move this forward?
Okay, great question. So where does regulation fit in to move us forward? So if you use the harm principles and some of the tests, you can say, for example, I mean, I gave you examples of like 100 regulation attempts already. They share the idea that boiled down to Wollstonecraft. They share the idea that if you have if you have harms, so if you have a lack of privacy, that's a harm. I think in a lot of them, they just pull out one and they say privacy is important. But I think you should look at it instead as if AI is doing things that cause harm and you can enumerate those harms, then it's bad. So let's look at right to be forgotten, for example. So if you want the right to be forgotten, and again, this was covered in the keynotes, so I'm very appreciative, but they basically lay out that you want a way of changing the results. It's not that you, in a very numeric sense, want every record that's ever been said about you to be erased. In fact, the law is such that if you have a business purpose for using the data, it doesn't get erased. So if there's a clear use of it, it's fine. The question is, if it's used in a way that you don't like, for example, your enslavement, or for profit on your body of data, if you feel like you're being abused or used in a way you don't want, then you should be able to stop that. So regulation looks at, I think, harm in a way that we could have technical regulations, as opposed to very sort of high-level ones, that said, I mean, right to erasure became a lot of people trying to think of how can we do that in a technology space. You could actually instead say, how can I exit? So if I don't like how my data is being used, how can I remove my data? I need to have the right of removal. And so you get harm principles. My last thought on that is I've actually had people in the United Nations argue, please don't use us as the deliberative body because we're already having trouble getting a lot of other ethical things pushed through the world. Like the ban on mines, for example, or children's rights. United States refuses to sign the Convention on the Rights of the Child because Americans believe that you should be able to do whatever you want to children, and it's the only country in the world where they don't have rights. And so, fine, we don't have to use the United Nations as a deliberative body or a global body, but we should have the ability to represent when somebody wants a right, when they want to be protected, they have a technical way to do that. And the regulations fit in by saying, you must build the technical measures to represent the rights people deserve. And I've described those as two things right now, power off and reset. If the AI takes me down a path I don't like, can I reset it to prior? Taking a loss of life, for example, is something you can't reset. So the answer would be no. If you kill people, you can't undo the death. Power off is, can I get off this and go to another platform? Well, in the case of Facebook, you can't take your stuff off and put it on another Facebook. That's not the way they're designed. So in those two cases, it would change the market through regulation.
Yes. Hi. With the fast pace of using and adopting AI and the technology, is it safe to use AI to detect and probably prevent even the unsafe usage of AI?
Yeah, so that's like saying the question is, could you use intelligence to prevent bad things by other intelligent beings? That literally, again, from the keynote, I have to pull from it because it was very excellent this morning. You know, when they said, how do you feel about crypto AG being compromised? You know, Witt said, I really believe in intelligence because what's worse than two nuclear powers, but two nuclear powers that don't know anything about each other. So yeah, of course you could use monitoring by machines of machines. You could audit machines with machines that are auditing it, but it comes back to what's the desired outcome. And I think the cutting edge science around this, when you really get into, you know, PhDs at Berkeley and so forth around the world, especially in Europe, I see a lot of them researching how to represent the safer machine, they often say, we're not going to do it mathematically, so the machine watching machine isn't going to just be counting, you know, up and down simple numbers. It's going to be saying, our objective here is to have a safe working environment. And so what they're measuring is, are there accidents, not in a purely numeric way, but in a predictive way. Is your behavior likely to cause an accident? So Tesla is a perfect example of that. If we had machines monitoring Tesla on the road, I mean, you have cameras all over the roads at this point, you have sensors in the cars themselves. So if you had machines monitoring Tesla as opposed to Tesla monitoring Tesla, I think we'd have a better outcome. Tesla would be banned from the road at this point. I'm not kidding. I honestly think that Tesla should be banned from the road at this point based on their behavior. And I'm not just saying that because Tesla misbehaves. I'm saying that because there are rogue Teslas. There are literally Teslas that are off the Tesla network being run by other networks that we have no visibility into. And so they literally can be, like in the Uber case, moved onto the sidewalk and start running over people in cities. And what would you do? You can't go to Tesla and say, stop this. They're running off some other rogue server. That's a break at the infrastructure level that turns into a Breaking Bad because the entire system now is untrusted. Nobody wants the Teslas in the city. It's not just that one went bad and crashed into a wall. It's they're all untrusted. So that's where science takes us to, do you have a way of instrumenting and proving that what you're doing isn't going to lead to mass casualty? Yes.
I saw your construct in terms of looking at big entities that control the data, control your lives, and you used a lot of poignant examples of big companies like Google, Facebook, Tesla as an example, Uber, and depicted them in a negative way, I think, as it relates to your construct. But the question is if you started with a sense of that war and power is a deception of warfare, could you kind of predict the future of how you see the warfare between these major entities that are impacting our lives, Google, Facebook, Uber, Amazon, versus other our individual selves? What is the deception? What's the power? And what's the battle going to be in the next 5 years?
Okay, great question. So where's the battle space, you know, and how is it being waged? And it's actually not just the next 5 years, it's the last 5 years. For example, we found that in these large tech companies, if women showed breasts, for example, they were flagged as violations of terms of service. And there's lots of reasons why they were trying to erase women from the conversation. Women who were sex workers were deemed as offensive by some. And so there was all this attempt to sort of shame and erase women on platforms because of risky behavior as judged by the platforms. However, white supremacists and far-right groups, Nazis, were given free rein, and they continued to grow and build conspiracy theories that led to actual attacks. And not just white supremacists. We saw this also with the Muslims being targeted in Myanmar. So you actually had, and India as well, you've had conspiracies built where people would just literally go and attack some random person and beat people up because there was a conspiracy that was built into the algorithms that would be fed to people. So the battle space is in creating a movement of people that will actually act upon something in a violent way. And so that's classic. I mean, if you go back to the 1940s, for example, maybe one of the best examples is the United States had to invade North Africa, basically to take it away from the occupiers. And so you had to convince people who were actually living in North Africa that these invaders were going to come and liberate you from other people who were occupying the country. That's a lot of information that has to be gleaned on what will convince them that you're the good guys and they're the bad guys, and then how will they see you as the liberators of that space. Now, I'm not just making that up as, you know, well, that's a complicated example from history of information warfare. That's the birth of the CIA. That's where OSS started. That's where the CIA came from. And so the entire history of the CIA, which has been a lot of information, deception, and warfare, has been baked in from the idea that you have to basically go in places and liberate the oppressed from, you know, their occupiers and have them sort of rise up and be self-sufficient. So in the last 5 years and in the coming 5 years, all this is around where do people get their liberty from? And are there groups that are trying to oppress them that are using the technology in ways that keep them from representing themselves and are representing instead essentially conspiracy theories, which is you don't have rights, you don't exist, you don't deserve to have rights. You can be beaten up at any time by a group of people who deserve to beat you up because, you know, you're a terrible person. So you're shifting all of the sense of safety around the principle of information, and it's already happening. It's happening on Twitter, it's happening on Facebook. And the fact that they moved so slowly is evidence that they didn't feel the feedback loop was completely broken. They didn't feel any sort of personal stake in this game. In the same way that if you look at the Grover Shoe Factory, not to tie all these things in, but I think they're all relevant. The Grover Shoe Factory was the end of all the manufacturers saying, you can't regulate us. You're getting in the way. We know what we're doing. But they burned down two city blocks and killed everybody. That was the end. The Triangle Fire is another example in New York City. So we've seen those disasters. Another one is obviously election tampering. So were they able to convince people to vote a certain way? That's direct interference in liberty. That's direct interference in an election system. And so that warfare has been going on for some time. You want to shift power? So I could give you examples over the 1960s, 70s, 80s in the continent of Africa and the continent of Asia. That's how it's been done in the past. But in the last 5 years, what I've seen is women being systematically erased, their voice being erased, the disempowerment of women on these platforms, and the rise of white supremacists, because they're aggressively trying to target people and elevate their own power using technology, which is what they've always done. And so that's why I think you see now there's an elevated risk of white supremacy on the terror scale in the United States, is because they've been able to leverage terror platforms, which is basically information platforms. Yeah, the same way you might have leveraged automatic rifle. Or more to the point, let me put it in terms of, if you take barbed wire and you take repeating rifles and you take the steam engines and you put them together, what do you get? Concentration camps. But individually, people didn't see that coming. They saw them as beneficial. They saw them as potentially having lots of good. Barbed wire was a way of fencing. It was very inexpensive. It gave you basically claims to your land. Repeating rifle allowed you to defend yourself from other groups. So it was a way of actually expressing your own rights and your liberties. The steam engine allowed you to move goods around. So it actually is a commerce system. But if you put them together, the right combination of technologies can imbalance power in a way that's extremely destructive. And so I think what people see is if they can actually use technology today in the same way to imbalance power, they immediately grab that power. And so what I'm seeing is the decline of minority rights and decline of women rights and traditional patterns of oppression and the gasp for power by a small group that wants to maintain superiority over them. Any other questions? I think we're done. All right, thank you.